Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm telling you, every episode is getting better and better. You guys will not believe. Look, I got my tea in my hand. I'm just too comfortable because my mom is here. I have my mother here. Kine Gueye Thiam. Can I say Kine Gueye Thiam?
That's my maiden name.
Yes.
What's my maiden?
Which is, you know, that's also okay. Let me introduce her and then we'll get into that. Her name is Kine Gueye Thiam. My mom is the CEO of Confidence Foundation. So they service young children in Africa and America. Together, her and Akon and the family, it's our family foundation, but she's a mother first. So today on What's Your Side, we're gonna talk to her more about how it was for her as a Senegalese immigrant in America, raising American children, but also teaching us where we came from, making sure we have a good foundation, and you know, the whole thing. So, hi mom.
Hey sweetie.
How you doing?
Well, I'm so surprised you say raising American children. You know how we get into
that. Well, yeah, we get into, so let me talk about that.
We get into that, you and a lot, because what I say to you guys all the time, you guys appear Senegalese American with your bloodline being African.
Yeah.
Come from me and your dad. With your passport say American.
Yeah.
And you guys always say, no, mom, we are African. I'm like, well,
which
I am the African one. Don't
wow. You see what we go through? It's like,
I say, I'm no. The African now. That's what I want to, when I want to mess with you guys, that's what
yes,
I say.
Yes, when she wanted to mess with us, she was like, see, and you call yourself African? Africans don't do what you just did.
Yeah, I'm like, Africa, we do have difference. And that difference, see, that's where we bump heads sometimes.
Okay.
Because, you know, here in America, raising kids is so different from raising kids in Africa.
Right, sure.
And, but your surrounding, it's hard for me to actually bring Africa to you without you being in Africa.
Right,
yes.
Right. That's yeah. true, that yeah. is true. So, okay, we could get into that. So, 1969, you step foot in America.
Yeah.
You're here, my father's here, you're 16 years old. Mm-hmm. Along the way, you have four boys in St. Louis, Missouri.
Yes.
How was that? You're a Senegalese immigrant here, now in America. Mind you, that's the height of the civil rights movement. Mm-hmm. You're raising now Black African American boys. How was that to still know that they're African, but knowing you're in America raising them?
Well, to us African, the foundation you put in your children lasts a long way.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's here what they call here as a childhood education.
Right, right.
So being in Senegalese, even though I came here very young, what was stalling me, it was my foundation to keep me not cross my boundaries.
Right.
Because it's all about what you actually, where you come from.
Mm-hmm.
Where I come from, there's things, no matter what happened, there's just a boundary, you can't go across that. So when you guys started coming along, I say, your brothers, being a boy is in America, you like raising boy, I say, even though we have two parents in a house.
Right.
Which is, I always said, it takes two to raise
100%
kids.
Yes.
Now, Africa, we say it takes a village.
Yeah,
now, the village is what's missing in America.
Because
raising a kid in Africa, not just you got your mom and you got your dad and your uncles and auntie, you got your neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
So if my mama was to go out of town, we always say, oh man, I wish my mom not gonna stay long because the neighbors.
I know, they're worse.
The neighbors are tougher than my parents.
Yes, yeah.
I can go down the store just to get something. They go, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
You know, your mom is not here.
Yeah.
So I'm just like, I just went to come in to get some candy or whatever that I can make excuses.
Right.
So they're gonna make sure I get home.
Right.
Now here in America, you see your child somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
Neighbors will just go pass by. Now, if you got a good neighbor, let's try to do a neighborly responsibility.
Yeah.
It's depending on parents. You can correct other kids here in America.
Right, yeah.
I learned this early on when I first came here. Because I thought, you know, if you see your neighbor's kids outside doing something,
yeah.
you actually put in your word, hey, what are you doing here? Go home. They look at you like, who are you talking to?
Right.
You're not my parents.
Right, right, right. Yeah.
So that's the only difference between raising kids in America and Africa. We don't have the village. Not only we don't have the village, we don't allow the neighbors or the teachers. Or the teachers. I remember your brothers when they were in school. But the teacher ever called me, one of my son, very energetic but very smart, Omar. Mm-hmm. Omar will finish his work and starting playing in his desk.
Right.
And I said, well, Omar, you can't do that. Like, well, I'm done. This was too easy.
Right. Yeah. He's super smart.
So the teacher will call me when I tell the teachers, listen, you want me to bring you a belt?
Oh, wow.
If he doesn't listen. So, and I said that to all of the teachers. So they say, you know, Miss Kine, if all the parents were like you, it's going to make our job very easy. Mm-hmm. Because not only the kids going to know I'm not going to take up for them, they don't have to use it.
Right.
Because I give them a permission to use it.
Right.
If they go actually beyond where they're supposed to be. I teach my kids to be respectful. Mm-hmm. But sometimes kids can be copycat.
Right. So we all know, like in Africa, they'll like the mother gets to blame for everything. So if your child does good, you know, now that's everybody's child. Now he or her has so many moms, dads, uncles, cousins that they never knew. But now the minute your child does bad, it's like, oh, that's Kine's daughter, Kine's son.
Do you see Kine's son over there, what she did?
Yes.
And that's what I was trying to tell you guys. Mm-hmm. Even now you're an adult and say in America, 18, 19, or you in your own, but whatever you do, they say, well, you know, he's grown, honey, you gotta do what you want, you gotta be happy.
Right.
No.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, Africa is, no matter how old you are, your brother who's famous and all over, if anything in the news, first thing they're, where is his mom? Mm-hmm. Not only that I have grown a man.
Right. No, that's true.
Where is his mom? Mm-hmm. So your mom is responsible for everything. Mm-hmm. And when they say mama's job never done, that is the truth.
Yeah. Also, let's talk about before he was on the news. Before he was on the news, we all know he was getting into a little bit of trouble. You know, he got locked up. The song's out there, so there's no secret. He got locked
and
up.
And I let him stay locked up.
You let him stay. So walk us through that phone call. He got locked up. He's like, Mom, you'll never believe what happened. I'm like, talk to us through that first phone call that you got.
Well, this is what happened. First, before even all that happened, I'm always watch my kids surrounding, kids that want to come and hang out with him. And my thing was always, you know what, son, come here. I don't like that boy. I don't like the way he wear his hair. Mm-hmm. Look at how he dressed. Mm-hmm. Can he pick up his pants? Pants drive has been going on. That's how I remember with his young
sagging
kids.
Pants.
Sagging pants. So for me, what they say, the first impression is really important.
Yeah.
If you come to people's house and here you're looking like somebody America's most wanted. Mm-hmm. So you're I'm like, I don't like him.
Right.
I don't like that boy. He's like, Mom, you know, he's a good guy. This is just his style. I'm like, well, I don't like his style. Mm-hmm. So from there, some of those boys are just like what I was thinking they were. Khan was in the school, never skipped school. We go to vacation every Africa. Every
year to
Africa. To
Senegal.
We go to Africa and spend his vacation. Mm-hmm. So when that happened, everybody were like, what happened? And I explained to them what happened, but just to go back to what you're saying, when he was riding with one of his friends, they were going to New Jersey. Mm-hmm. Now, this accident is a guy who's old enough to be his dad.
Okay.
And I know who he is, but I'm not, you guys know. Mm-hmm. He used to come to the house, driving all these fancy cars, Khan being very smart, because when he was in the school, he wanted to be a pilot, so he's really smart even now.
So Akon wanted to be a pilot.
Yeah. Akon wanted to be a pilot. Mm-hmm. So he was very good technology. Mm-hmm. So the guy will come in, I have a computer in the house. He'll try to tell him to teach him how to use the computer. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, how does grown man want you to teach him? Like, Mom, you know, they just not, he's done, I'm just gonna help him. Mm-hmm. But not knowing he was trying to get him to show him how to change VIN numbers in my computer.
Wow. On your computer?
I could have been locked up myself.
That's true.
if the feds come in my house.
You would have locked up part two.
And I'm like,
the female version.
So he'll come in my house and he's doing his homework and the guy's sitting in, have him working with him on his computer. But I, all alone, until it happened, I didn't know what they were doing.
Right.
But I know the whole thing afterward.
Right.
So they were going to New Jersey, so he asked him to, you know, drive the car. Mm-hmm. And they got to stop in the Holland tunnels. Mm-hmm. So what he told him is, well, just say you're the driver, because you have no record, you're a clean kid. Me, I'm going forever, if they know that's me. Mm-hmm. So There you go. The car was dirty car, so they tagged them, and here he goes. And there, I think there was something happened that I didn't know at that time.
Yeah.
And somebody banned them out, and they have to bring them to Georgia,
yeah,
in DeKalb County. Mm-hmm. That's what I know. If things work out in New Jersey, I would know nothing about it.
Right, right.
Because there's something happened earlier with that man, and I didn't know.
Okay.
They hide it from me. Don't tell his mom. Man, Miss Kine going to kill us.
Yeah.
No, you can't tell mom. You're just going to get you out.
Yeah.
So when they bring them to Atlanta, he called me. This is DeKalb County. And this is phone call. Hey, this is a collector call from that time, whatever. He didn't really have the aircon name, Ali. I'm like, DeKalb County, what is that? What is that? I didn't even know what that was.
Right. Yeah. I forgot you reached a collect call from inmate. I think that's how they say it.
Yeah, and I'm like, inmate, what is going on? And I'm like, it's like, maybe you're going to accept it or no.
Oh, what? That was rude back then. I think that was just the operator.
No,
now.
And then I accept it. And then he said, Mom, I'm like, what's going on? Mama, I need to come home. I said, what happened? So he told me this. I said, oh, really? Well, okay, you can stay there.
Oh, wow.
He's like, no, Mama, I want to come home. I'm like, you want to come home? Well, I'll call you back. No, you can't call me back. I can call you back. So I asked, tell me where it is. So they told me, I first went there. Mm-hmm. And they said, they tell me when you're supposed to come in and da-da-da. So I came home and then I cook. And I said, I'm going to take him something to eat.
Mm-hmm.
So I came in there with the food, and the guy said, where are you going?
Like, she went to go visit him in jail with food. That's so cute, though.
Well, because
that is cute. But
let me tell you what they do in Africa.
Yeah, they do.
They feed you very horrible food, so when you get out of here, you really don't want to come back.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
If you want to eat, your family got to bring you food.
Wow. So, at least they got the option, though. I'm sure
they have the option, because so I said, okay. I know the food is horrible. I don't know what happened, but I don't want him to eat bad food.
That's so cute.
Since I'm always cooking, so I take the food. And they tell me, well, ma'am, you can bring it here. I'm like, well, how he gonna eat?
Aww.
They say, well, we got food for him.
Mm-hmm.
I say, okay, so well, go put it in your car and come back. So I went in and put it in my car, come back, and they let me go. And for me, just going there to see him is like I'm going to a funeral.
Right.
And I see people in the lobby just giggling, and I'm like, are these people coming to see somebody in jail and they're laughing like that?
Yeah.
So to tell you, because this is the first time in my life having anybody locked up.
Right.
I came in and I thought I'm just going to go ahead and we're going to go in a living room or something. He's got this glass.
She said a living room.
This glass behind us. He's between us and he picked up the phone, and they said, pick up the phone. I'm like, I got to. So he said, Mom, I want to come home. I said, really? He said, well, how you like your neighbors? He's like, what neighbors? I'm like, those guys over there. Mom, I want to come home. These are not my neighbors. I said, you know what? He got a bail. I said, but you know what? I'm not going to bail you out. You know what? Mm-hmm. I want you to stay here long enough to think about what happened.
Wow.
So when you get out of here, you're not going to think coming back.
Right, right.
Because this is not the child that I raised.
Right.
But what he learned from the outside of peer pressure,
yeah,
and other bad behavior, which is what they say in my country, some of your friends, I'm going to tell you who you are.
Right.
If you want to go in the right direction, you got to ride with the right people.
Right, right, right.
Now, that being said, after that, then that man itself came to my house.
Mm-hmm.
And he know he does. He's going to wipe this like your mom is talking about me. He called me and said, Mom, I'm just going to tell you I'm sorry what happened to Akon, but we're going to bail him out.
Mm-hmm.
I said, no, we're not bailing him out. He's like, no, we're going to bail him out. I got $2,000. The bail is $2,000. And, you know, and it's not wasn't $2,000, but that's what he told me. The bail is $2,000. We're going to go get him. That was my fault. And I refused to bail him out.
Mm-hmm.
So I let him stay. I think he stayed there for about a few months.
Mm-hmm.
The lawyer, Steve, called me and said, Ms. Thiam, he can get a bail. We got to bail him out. I said, I don't know. He said, no, we got to bail him out because he.
Mama, you worse than the judge.
We got to bail him out.
We're just going to wait a year?
The lawyer said, you know, we're going to bail him out. And I still refused. And 2 weeks later, they dropped all charges. Because what they say is they keep him there after he not bail out, even though he got a bail, to figure out who's behind all of this. Because what they do, they go to your school record,
mm-hmm.
and they see he was a perfect attendance.
Okay.
He never get in trouble. Mm-hmm. So they just like, there's just somebody else behind this. So they tried to get him to give out who behind the whole scene. Mm-hmm. And he wouldn't do it.
Yeah.
Because he figured even if he end up doing some time for him, he'd be shorter because he's young.
Yeah.
And never did nothing.
Yeah.
So he just feels sorry for the guy, like he's always been a good-hearted person. Mm-hmm. So Steve called me, said, "Miss Thiam, your client is coming home." I'm like, "How?" He said, "They drop all charges." So they drop all charges.
But that was God, because you would have kept him there forever.
Well, you know what? Because
I mean, when was you going to let the man out? Is my question. I'm happy I've never been to jail.
Well, no, well, let me tell
you. I'd be in trouble.
That's another story.
Messing with you.
Well, like, all of them will tell me when it's come to parenting, I'm firm. I did this subject to Tamika driving without a license.
Yes, she's very firm. Oh my God. I don't know. Do we want to tell that story? Tell the story. And
I say, well,
we'll see. If this story makes the show, that means Tamika gave us permission to tell the story. Well, so go ahead and tell the story.
I tell them that all the time. You actually hear God suspended your actually your license.
Yeah.
Because for one reason, he took the money he was going to go get his insurance. His insurance was expired, her insurance. Mm-hmm. She said, "Why give my husband the money?" I'm like, "What? Mm-hmm. You're not going to get your license, your insurance renewal?" He's like, "Yeah, my husband was going to the studio and, you know, I gave him the money so he can have money in his pocket."
Yeah, she's
so sweet. They were living in my house at that time.
But that was sweet.
What? No, that was sweet, but let me just tell you. He got the keys in the car. And they were actually driving and he got stopped. Mm-hmm. She got stopped. So, first they're gonna say, "We're gonna take you in. Do you have anybody come pick up the kids?" She called me. I said, "Yeah, I'm gonna pick up my grandkid, but I'm gonna let you go to jail." He's like, "Mom."
Mom, guys. You wanted to meet her. Well, hey, you met her.
I said, "You know why? Because you're going to, the next time, you're going to remember what's most important."
One thing I can say, they both only been to jail once.
Once.
I can say, I think once you go under her wing and, I don't even know if that's a wing. I don't know what
that
is.
Well, let me say, once you go under
your school, your
skill of kidney, you graduate.
Once you graduate from the school of kidney and mess up, and once you're in the school of kidney, mess up and go to jail while you're in the school of kidney, you'll probably graduate with time served before you graduate with like a diploma, but you'll never go back to jail again. So I guess,
well, you know what I was saying is, well, that was the first time when his husband made that mistake and never went back.
Yeah.
So she's, and now I know what that is, because now it's one time. And then here she come. How you just, you know, you say you forgot your incense was expired, but you got the money and you're gonna go get it. But you're like, "Well, honey, did you take the money?" I'm like, "Are you serious?" "You know what? You're just crazy." So I'll come and pick up my grandkids. I'm gonna send you to jail. You sit down there for a little
bit. I'm gonna send you to jail.
Because the cops go take you anyway.
Yeah.
But I come and get my grandkids.
Yes, well, you got the kids.
So that day when he did, he called your dad. He's like, "Dad, you're not gonna, mom let me go to jail because he said I gave the money to my husband." Mm-hmm. Your husband is working on his music, but at that time, he's just a hungry artist. Mm-hmm. We pay the bill.
We'll say upcoming on the show. upcoming artist.
He's coming. I mean, upcoming.
Yes.
And they have this tier in my house. Boy, yes. All my lights, I pay the bills.
Yeah. So they're running up the light bill for sure at your house.
The money you're going to go and get your insurance renewal, you're going to take them and just give them to spend. His first priority, what I taught him, is his home and his family.
Yeah.
So if that's not taken care of, you're not going to take the money for that and go and just to put in your pocket.
Yeah.
But you know, you young people, you die and ride. Do you know what they call ride and die?
Ride or die. Yeah. Well, you guys don't ride or die? Well, we're going to have another. Well, we're going to have part 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 with her. But we're going to definitely have to get into relationships because I think we would love to hear what she has to say about that. We'll hold that.
But actually, that's what it is with me raising my kids, is including raising my daughter-in-law.
Yeah.
Because she's just my daughter.
Yeah.
So I have to teach her life lessons.
Yeah.
Because what she did was good. But it's just that how she did it. To me, I'm thinking, if I have to ride my car with my kids, that's my first responsibility.
Mm-hmm. Now, it was just the timing was bad.
The time was bad.
It ended up, yeah.
Yeah, but I just think at that time that was not a smart decision. You know, I mean, my children come first. Mm-hmm. They're riding in my car. What if I was out of town? The kid's gonna go to defect. Mm. That's what you guys call it?
Defects.
Defects. Mm-hmm. So do you rather do that or just do the right thing? Say, honey, we're gonna get the insurance, because sometimes men don't think. That's why it's always, and my daughter-in-law, she's a sweet woman. Mm-hmm. Think for her.
Yeah.
Because they say your wife pick up where your mom left out.
100, and that's
she
what
did,
she's
she
done.
Did that.
Yeah. We love you, Meek.
Yes.
Tamika. We love you, Tamika.
Tamika.
Yes.
That's my daughter-in-law that I say, you know, they say your first wife is always going to be your mother.
Mm.
Now, when we say first wife, that's your first marriage.
Mm.
That's what they said.
Mm-hmm.
And she got a lot of me plus. Mm-hmm. Some things that I'm like, I'm not doing that.
Mm-hmm. Obviously. I think you made that clear here today.
I'm just a little tougher than her. But she's a great woman, and thank God for her.
Mm-hmm.
I always say that if you got, bless you with a great woman,
mm-hmm.
understand what you got and take care of that.
Yeah.
Don't let it get away, because they're not going to come. You know, when it is true, it's not going to come around twice.
Mm.
If you have a good one and men, you let it slip away, it's never going to come around.
Okay, wait, Ma. I think let's give a moment for the men to hear that.
Yes.
The ones that are married right now. Mm-hmm. Maybe even have really good girlfriends that are potential.
I don't know about girlfriends.
We won't talk about girlfriends right now. So let's keep it. Men that are married right now, knowing that they're married to a good woman, what did you just say?
Keep it, because once you lose it, they're not going to come around. That's not going to come around.
A good woman like that is not going to come around twice.
It's not going to come around twice. That's what they always said. If you get it, like you go in a bad marriage.
Yeah.
If the one that was good in the marriage.
Yeah.
If the one abused the marriage. If you lose the one that is good,
yeah.
You will never get that one back. You're going to get the opposite.
You're going to get the opposite.
What you actually lost.
Yeah.
So you do your part. You can only control your part.
Yeah, that's true.
So if you do your job right, whatever that one, if you want to stay, stay with good heart. Don't stay for any other reason.
Yeah.
And if you can't do it, if you're starting doing it, your heart can't take it. It's better to leave.
It's better to leave.
Because at that point, the purpose is not.
Yeah. Well, listen, grab some of your tea. We're comfortable, because the next subject mm-hmm. is the best subject.
Mm-hmm. The best subject.
Yeah, because you have four boys. I mean, God, how tiring was that before I came along? The only girl and the baby girl. I know. It was tough for me, guys. I'll tell y'all about that later. But I mean, you have four boys back, not back to back, but what kind of? They're a couple years apart. But then I come like later in life, and it's a girl. Like, talk to us about that. Like, when you laid eyes on me, and you know, I'm a little girl, and like, okay, now I was raising little boys, now I gotta raise this chocolate little girl here in America. Talk to us about it. You can tell them everything. Tell them everything about me.
Well, you got to be chocolate, because I'm not really dark, and your daddy's was really dark.
Yeah.
So if I bring in bright color, they're going to say, where you got that from?
Yeah. They will start asking questions.
But thank God.
Yeah.
When you came in, the doc said, oh, thank God he looked like his mom. Her mom. Because that time we don't have... well, you tell you what just happened.
Oh, what is that sonogram, I think they call it?
We don't have, that time you don't know.
Well, the ultrasound.
Yeah, they have.
Did you have ultrasound?
They did, but we don't have what they can tell you,
the
gender revealing.
Yeah.
We don't have that. You got to wait until you have the child. And you tell you have a boy or girl. So after keep trying every 2 years for a girl,
mm-hmm.
I said, I'm done. I'm going to have five boys.
Then here
you come. I'm like, thank God. I try one more time. That's why you and Boo are 8 years apart.
Right, yes.
You're 8 years apart. So when you came in, raising a boy, four boys after that, raising a girl, that was a challenge. Because now I have to learn how to raise a girl.
That's true.
But then I'm a woman.
Right.
And been a girl.
Right.
So raising you, the difference was, I don't know if you remember, your friends always say, well, your mom don't want you to go anywhere.
Yeah, she was very overprotective is a nice way to say it.
Mm-hmm.
but she was, yeah, they probably would have called me shelter growing up. You guys will see from the Akon interview, I didn't know much about the whole drug pen or whatever, you know, the whole drug, crime and drugs lifestyle, like the back end. But she had a lot to do with that too, because she really kept me
grounded.
Cool, we'll call it grounded. We'll call it grounded, sure. She kept me grounded.
I keep all my kids grounded.
Yes.
Even the older ones are still grounded.
Yes.
But raising a girl, mm-hmm. it's not easy in America. Because mm-hmm. what is out there right now, especially, I'm glad I don't have any girls right now. I have my granddaughters.
Right.
Which is, those are my grandkids. I'm worried about them now. Because mm-hmm. now mm-hmm. what are there, and I only tell you, I told your friend yesterday, you're a pretty girl.
Yeah.
You know, the way the dress code, all they got, all this hanging, sewing, everything, mm-hmm. is unnecessary. Mm-hmm. Because that's not, if you think that's going to bring the guy to you, mm-hmm. no man want something everybody's seeing. Mm-hmm. So you want it to yourself. So respect to yourself if you want to be respected. Mm-hmm. But going back to bring you as a young girl, have your friends in the school coming home with you.
Yeah.
I didn't have them home. Playing with you, feed them, instead of you going with them.
All right.
Because of every house have their boundary and the way they raise their children. Mm-hmm. Their mom probably have, just only have what, know what they have, what they taught them. Mm-hmm. What I was teach as a young lady growing up, I cannot go get out after 7 o'clock. Mm-hmm. Wherever I go, I have to come home by 7. Mm-hmm. And I have to know, they have to know where I'm going. Mm-hmm. Now, if I tell you, you can go here, they said, why your mom don't let you go? We're going over there. You can come with us. And I said, no, she's not going. Mm-hmm. Now, there's a lot of time you never went to the movies with your friends until you was.
Yeah, well, thank God for my best friend, Denisha. Denisha. When I wasn't able to really go out that much until I met my best friend, Denisha, whose mother was very similar to my mom. Anytime you call Denisha, her mom's like, Denisha's not taking calls right now. But then when she got to know me, it's like, I think me and Denisha saved each other. The mm-hmm. Only thing about Denisha's mom and my mom, they're very smart. So the minute we tried to sneak out together, we got caught. It's probably because of how we did it. Denisha says I came up with the idea, but I don't remember.
Why are you saying that you guys come in and do sleep over
in
my
house?
Yeah,
but there was one time we wanted to go to a party. So I guess if Denisha says I came up with it, I'll go with that for right now. Let me know if it was smart or not, y'all. But Denisha told her mom she was spending the night at my house, and then I told my mom I was spending the night at Denisha's house so we could go to this party. And then we just stayed the night at a friend's house, and then when she dropped me and Denisha off at my house, when Denisha's mom came to pick her up, she just had to say, oh, thank you for watching Denisha last. Like, they just had to have that whole thank you for letting Denisha come over last night. Mom's like, what? Denisha wasn't here last night. And it just was a mess. It was a mess.
And then what I did with you was I said, okay, you're in punishment.
Yeah.
And
I'm just happy I'm in my 30s now, y'all. It was rough. It was rough.
Well, your brother's in his late, older than 30, but I still give him the time out. Mm-hmm. So what I did with you after that day, I'm like, you know what? No more out, no more friend.
Mm-hmm. Well, not forever. I know how the way she talked, y'all probably thought
no,
I was
I did
like,
that. I said, no more
kids. In prison myself. We talked about everybody that went to prison, but it sounded like I was under her prison. But it wasn't that bad until I went to college. We'll talk about that later.
Even before you went to college.
Yeah.
I have to put in the foundation. Because let me tell you, discipline is starting early on.
Yeah.
You don't let the kids until they're 20 years old and you say, well, now I'm going to discipline you. You got to have to start them young. Because mm-hmm. What they put in you at an early age will last for a long time. Mm-hmm. And that's why when I came here at an early age, I can't go across my boundaries because I know what my parents taught me. Mm-hmm. Anything I cannot done when I was back home, I can't do it here. Mm-hmm. If I know if I done that when my father were raising me or my mom, they're going to be displeased with me. I will not do it even if they're no longer here. Mm-hmm. So that's the difference between raising kids in America and raising kids in Africa. Your parents are responsible for you. I don't care if you're 50 years old. Mm-hmm. If they see you somewhere doing something, they're like, what happened? Where's his parents? Mm-hmm. They're asking about my son. When they hear something, where you at? I'm like, he's grown. Oh, no, he's not grown yet. Because mm-hmm. that's the truth. Africa, you never grown. I don't care.
Yeah, like,
30,
let's talk
40,
about,
50.
So we'll talk about that. We talked about raising me. I feel like half of the audience feels sorry for me as they hear the story. But I survived. I'm good.
You're good.
But now, and I'm sure every African child goes through this whole grown, maybe we should use another word, like, mother, I'm an adult now. Do you mm-hmm. think if I said that to you? Like instead of saying, I'm grown.
You can never say to your parents, I'm grown.
Okay, what about I'm an adult now? I have a child.
Well, you got a child. The child is your responsibility to raise. I'm still raising you.
Okay.
That's the thing. We don't just give up because you grown, you have your own kids.
Right.
You hear me talk about that with your brother them. Mm-hmm. You know, mom, they're grown. I'm like, grown where? Mm-hmm. No, you're not, they're not grown.
Okay, but what about, okay.
Every African, let me tell you, this is the thing about being in Africa. Every African parents will tell you the same thing.
Yeah.
My brother them, they got their wife and kids. They don't move a thing without talking to my mom when she was alive. Because mm-hmm. if she heard about, like, why you did that? Mm-hmm. You think they have freedom, they're grown. Mm-hmm. No, they're not grown. Because mm-hmm. let me tell you, what we always said, we close our eyes and see everything. Mm-hmm. You get your eyes open and see nothing. Mm-hmm. So parents always there for your guidance. Mm-hmm. We don't have therapists and counselors. That's your parents.
Right.
Your parents are your counselor, your therapist. Mm-hmm. Now here they can go and pay a lot of money to a stranger and tell them all their laundry. And they tell them, well, do this and do this. But if your mom say, you're like, ah, oh, my mom is so controlled.
Well, can you guys just be a little easier, I guess, how you talk to us?
Well, it's just the way you said. How should I say it? My mom didn't like how to say it to me. She just said it.
Okay.
But you know why you mm-hmm. say that, though? Because mm-hmm. here, you don't have the permission to tell your kids, mm-hmm. well, you cannot do that when they're 20 years old. Mm-hmm. We don't give whatever. I don't care if you're 20, 30, 40, 50.
So this is the same. Okay, so I have a son follow, as mm-hmm. you know. You would advise I treat how you do us, you would say I should do that to follow.
And you know what? That's what you, this is your footprint. Mm-hmm. Because to be honest with you, grow up with a strong religious father, disciplinary, but never whoopers and none of the, they just talk to you. Mm-hmm. My daddy will just look at you, you know what he means. Mm-hmm. He'll tell you your do's and your don'ts. Mm-hmm. So if you go otherwise do something else, when you see him, you're like, ah. Oh, it's my dad. I remember one time we went fishing. Mm-hmm. It's like a mile away from the house. Mm-hmm. It was good. We got a lot of fish. Mm-hmm. So I was supposed to be getting home at 7, but I went a little over 7 o'clock. But mm-hmm. I thought if I come home with all the fish, they're going to be happy. Mm-hmm. But when I came in, my daddy have the thing they call pleon. He's laying there and he's looking at me. Mm-hmm. I know, oh my God, my daddy's mad at me today. I'm going to get it because he's not a whooper, mm-hmm. but which one of us got that from him one time? Mm-hmm. And you don't want to get it again.
Right.
So when I came in with the fish and I see my mom, my dad lay down, my mom said, oh, your dad is mad today. I'm like, okay, first of all, I have to come in, apologize, mm-hmm. and let him know why that I stayed past 7 o'clock. Mm-hmm. It was just a lot of fish to catch and I want to make sure. You know, I just want to bring the fish to my mom so tomorrow she don't have to go to the market buy fish. Mm-hmm. She wasn't happy. But when I talked to him and apologized, I was hurt not knowing that I did something to hurt my dad. Mm-hmm. So that's the only time I ever remember doing something that displeased my dad. Mm-hmm. It never happened again.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
So from your point of view, how do you feel like you've done with us? I mean, you're here, you've given birth to Muhammad, Akon, Boo, Omar, mm-hmm. myself. You know, a lot of the world knows us, Akon especially, Boo, Omar, everybody. You know, talk to us about how does that feel? Like, do you feel like that had a lot to do with how you raised us? Or, because like the ratio of the kids that you have that are successful is pretty, it's a pretty good ratio, I would say. It's pretty
good
ratio.
Thank God. Well, there's a blessing and there's a curse. But this is but every success, it comes the blessing. Mm. Now, the thing is, what I try to tell my children is, I try to, just like say, always try to raise them the way that we come up. Mm-hmm. Which is in America is hard because I never thought none of my boys are going to have kids without getting married. Mm-hmm. That's a big thing for mm-hmm. us.
Oh.
That's true. Now, that might not be a popular subject in America because people don't wait for married to have kids. Mm-hmm. And it happened in my family, and that's something I have to deal with. But first of all, I never know the ones that, you know, those ones until they have to worry, think about how to tell me, because they're like, I'm gonna tell my mom.
Yeah, everything's how I'm gonna tell my mom.
I'm gonna tell my mom. Because that's what we don't really, and it's coming to me It's going to come back to me. What kind of mother do you have? What the parents? Why the parents allow them to do this? Not knowing that we don't allow them. Mm-hmm. We did what we know how to do, and we taught them way that we were taught, but do they going to follow? So man is a man. A good thing that I have one daughter I can tell, because I know right now if you were pop up with kids with no husband, it's your fault. I'm just saying that.
How would it be my fault?
Because we control.
Okay.
The thing is, man.
Wait a minute.
It is your fault. And I tell you, know what? You did a great job so far. Because
Let me just stick to that part.
Growing up, I say, Patty, if I have my way, your first boyfriend will be your husband. Now, in America, they say, oh, no, you got to date around, test around. That's a problem. Date around, yeah. Test around, no. So we're not raised like that. Moral issue, whether you're Christian, Muslim, you can read your Bible if you're Christian. It'll tell you. If you're Muslim, know your religion. Because they all tell you the same thing. For us, that's a moral issue. Now, you can get to know people. You can date. But dating and sleeping around is two different things. That's my problem with that. But you really actually did a good thing. Allow me, like we do it back home, your first husband.
Oh, I wasn't even gonna bring that up.
Yeah.
I wasn't even gonna bring up
your first husband.
Because I think a lot of people may still think I'm even married, though.
We did it the right way.
Very private, so I didn't announce it. But okay, well, I'm no longer married, since she wanted to, you know, put that out there.
We did it the right way as
okay,
African.
Okay, so now we'll have to talk about, like, everything now. Not everything.
Yeah, well, we just touched everything. But we did it the right. We did it right.
Okay, what does that mean when you say we did it the right way?
The first time. The second time, you're going to get my approval, but I'm not going to pick anybody. That's just
right.
Yes. But because what the thing is, which is nothing but it's true, when you're young, you've never been married before. So you don't know what to look for in a husband. But I do. And your dad know what to look for a man because he's a man. So our opinion is really count as African. When you go get married, you don't just come in. Oh, mom, this is Johnny. That's my husband. Oh, that's why when I'm going to get married, it doesn't work like that. First of all, personally, your first husband is going to be in, you know, let's back up and say your first wife. All Africans knows your parents going to look at where that woman come from, because this is the woman who's going to raise your children. So if you pick the wrong woman, you're going to have a house full of kids that don't know good. So the wife is very important. Wife, woman is actually the foundation of a great home.
Right.
Because no man stay home and raise the kids. It's the wife. So if you pick a great woman, you're going to raise a great family. So picking wife is really important to us. All my brothers, when they decide they want to have a wife, they'll say, you know, mom, it's time for me to get a wife. They say, you know what? I want you to go to so-and-so's house. Great mother, great father. They have great kids. That's how we pick wives. Not just somebody met in the club, you know, with the booties, shorts, and all of that. Those things.
Maybe it's 95 degrees outside. It's possible.
You can still, you know, that's another thing.
Okay.
If I was a man, I'm not marrying somebody I find in the club and booty shorts and breast hanging. No. Okay. You don't need to solve all of that. You're a beautiful woman.
Well, let's talk about a summer day, though. What if it really is 95
degrees
outside?
There's a really
outside?
Light fabric where you can wear something very nice that you don't have to sew everything. All African men will tell you that. I mean, I don't think even American men, really. Well, they can look. It's a free porno.
Okay.
Yeah, they can look. Every man enjoy free porno. But you think really that men is going to pick a woman who's out there hanging out and sewing everything? I don't think so. When you're beautiful, you're beautiful. I don't care how you dress. You can walk around with fully dressed, and men going to appreciate you.
And that's true. That is true.
They're going to appreciate you, and you know, you respect yourself. Because if you're looking for a wife, you're not looking at the video girls and all of that. They're not the one. Now, if you just want to hit and run, yeah, there you go.
And some of them are getting married. Some of them have gotten married.
Well, excuse me. I know that's not going to be a famous subject, but... there's some good girls.
There are some good girls.
Yeah, but even with that, I don't think leaving it all out is still the absent. Yeah. But
I think the title of this talk will be The Unpopular Opinions.
Yes.
Because my mom will say everything. She's like, I know this is not what, you know, this is not a favorite subject or not a favorite topic. And mm-hmm. It's unpopular opinion. It's like the opposite of what, like.
Yes.
Okay. So that would
No, that's just what it is. It's like picking a wife, mm-hmm. picking a husband. You wouldn't just come in. I'm not just the only African mother who say that. Mm-hmm. There's no way in Africa you're just going to come in. Mom, that's I'm gonna marry. Me and her are getting married, and I never met the girl. It's not gonna happen. Mm-hmm. What? Where you get that from?
It may happen, but it may not. It'd be a lot of chaos, turmoil.
Not in Africa. In America, yes.
Well, even with like an African mother, that could happen here with African American child, but she will not let them hear the last of how she didn't meet the
You're
woman
saying
or the
here,
husband.
I'm saying will never happen in Africa.
Okay.
And that's because
see, she does that too, like in Africa.
Everything
in America.
I am actually
okay.
Everything I'm doing, I'm reporting to Africa. That's where I'm from.
Yeah.
So my children, it's important for me to know where I come from. Because I said, well, if you don't know where you come from, you don't know where you're going.
Yeah.
If you don't believe in anything, you'll fall for anything.
Yeah, and that's definitely important right now as we speak.
It's exactly. Yeah. So your children is your footprints. Mm-hmm. If your children don't come out to be anybody, mm-hmm. They're like, oh, look at Kine's son. Mm. Now, right now, my son is everybody's kids. Mm-hmm. All of you, I'll say. I'm really proud of you guys. Mm. Oh, where's my daughter? Where's my son? Mm-hmm. But if you guys were actually something different, mm-hmm. or you just your mama's child. Mm-hmm.
So can we talk of this? The last thing I want to talk about with you is mm-hmm. the term ligeyune anyudom. Yes. Okay. Talk to us about what it means. All right.
But let me tell that's Wolof, but I'm going to say it in English. Mm-hmm. They say your mama's work is your lunch.
Mm-hmm. It's the kid's lunch.
It's the kid's lunch.
Yeah.
What your mama put up, that's mm-hmm. where your blessing come from.
Right.
And so that's what we say in Africa. People spend a lot of time in America. Sometimes they don't really, there's things that unhappy about the marriage. But if the kid, well, I'll just tell you, you guys saved my marriage 10 years longer than it should have been.
Okay. All right, yeah, we said.
No, you don't want
to. She's like, I've been wanting to say that part. Okay.
I'm like, no, I got
to. But I'm sure a lot of women could relate to that. Some women stay longer. A lot of women always, you would hear, I stayed longer because of the kids. I was thinking about the kids.
Because you're going to put, when you have kids, it's no longer you. It's you got to put your kids first.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you, when I after my firstborn, mm-hmm. it's not no longer me. I remember when Ekan was learning to walk. Mm-hmm. Johnny Seka, one of our cousins, was living in New York, mm-hmm. was the tour manager for Jackson 5. Mm-hmm. So they came to St. Louis doing a show. Mm-hmm. So they came to the house, and I was sewing. Mm-hmm. And Johnny said, I want you to be their stylist. Mm-hmm. I'm like, man, I don't have time. I got to take care of my kids. Mm-hmm. So like, no, listen. You don't have to do it. Just hire somebody mm-hmm. to do it. But you're going to be the stylist. Mm-hmm. But I know that at that time, my time, mm-hmm. My kids can share my time with nobody else.
Yeah.
It was my children and myself mm-hmm. and your father. Mm-hmm. So I turned that job down. Mm-hmm. I could have been a very famous styler now, mm-hmm. but I didn't regret
you
that.
You look good, if that counts.
The second thing was I was in a modeling school. I mm-hmm. didn't have the pictures with me, but I got them at home.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we probably could post the pictures. Okay, you're right. I have the pictures.
So that you got the pictures.
Yeah.
So they have, they tell your daddy we're going to New York mm-hmm. and we're going to do a photo shoot. Mm-hmm. And they picked me one of those models mm-hmm. for JCPenney. Mm-hmm. And your dad said no. But before your daddy said no, I would have told them I can't. I have two kids.
Oh, yeah.
And he said, well, maybe your husband can watch it. Let me talk to your husband.
Talk to him. Try.
And I said, maybe we could talk to your husband. I didn't know he's more tougher than me.
Right.
So he came to pick me up and then said, we were talking to your wife. We got mm-hmm. a great contract in New York. Mm-hmm. And they want her and this other two white girls mm-hmm. to do the cover for JCPenney. Mm-hmm. And he said, no, she cannot do it. I told him, but I don't want to do it anyway. Because at that time, mm-hmm. it's my children's. Mm-hmm. So over the years, what I do is I say, you know what? I know I'm not going to do anything going to take me away from my children. Mm-hmm. I create my own business.
Mm-hmm. You did.
Which we do, trade shows. Mm-hmm. It's weekends. Mm-hmm. Khan used to come and even help me after he got grow up, and I'll give him a couple of dollars, like, yeah, I make some money.
Yeah. You know, so. Wait, can I say this though? So y'all, I have to tell y'all this one thing. So when I got older, she had me helping her. And guess where she was selling that? Can I say?
Mm-hmm.
Freaknik. Y'all remember Freaknik back in Atlanta? So I'm probably 10, 11, 12. And Freaknik, I wish it was here. Because people who know, know. So while we're on the way to Freaknik, all you see is What am I trying to say? Convertible cars with the top open, women like bouncing, letting loose. So I'm like young seeing this, but my mom's so cute. She was an African woman at Freakney selling brass and jewelry. I mean, people were buying it though.
Well, you know, they buy it. Those people, when they're in those moments, they buy anything.
Yeah, you definitely was going to all of them.
People drunk and just paying whatever.
But that was so, and as I'm thinking about it now, I was like, oh, look at her at Freakney selling brass and African jewelry and wooden figurines and stuff.
And I was making more money than go get a job.
So how did you feel at Freakney though, Mom?
Like, well, Freakney was not one of my things.
Favorites? Not your
favorite. I go in the weekend and I can spend $500 and come with $2,000.
Yeah.
I don't want to get a regular job because I have kids and you know, I was newly divorced at that time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Well, we rave about your cooking all the time. Can you think we can do an episode with you cooking a recipe or two?
Next time, your next, a season?
Yeah.
We're going to do cooking.
She's like, season. That's so cute. So I'm going to have different seasons, y'all.
You know,
so
you
next season.
You know how to cook really good. Because that's another thing I didn't go into.
Okay.
Is that as a mother, if my daughters, you marry my daughters, don't know how to cook, they're going like, what kind of mother raised you?
Mm-hmm.
Now, in America, they just go get a cookbook.
Mm-hmm.
In Africa, it's my fault if you don't know how to cook. So I teach you a lot of dishes. You know how to cook very well.
Yeah.
So right now, you can marry any African man, and they're going to think they marry you from
Senegal. Yeah.
Because you know how to do all the dishes.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only thing I tell my sons, like my older son, Abu. Mm-hmm. He could call me, Mom.
Abu, you next.
Mom, what are you cooking?
I ain't
going to
bring you up about it, but she said it.
Mom, what are you cooking? I like, Boo, I want you to get a wife. Mom, this girl don't know how to cook. But it's another thing.
Mm-hmm.
In America, even this time we in, marriage and with a man, it has to be a bonus.
Mm.
Because if you're only getting everything in outside, what do you need the wife for?
Mm.
So, and I say that all the time. African men especially. I remember when we were actually in St. Louis, and even in Miami, we'll have this meeting and all of, and everybody were like, man, we gotta go grab something. And your daddy said, oh no, my wife cook.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, man, we need a wife like your wife. He's like, no, we don't eat, he never eat McDonald's or Burger King or all of these places.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes he'll call me and I can hear him say, oh, hold on, give me number one. I said, when you started eating number one? Number one or number two?
Right.
God forgive me. But that's back then, and this is just us. It's not about trying to, our job as a mother and as a wife.
Mm-hmm.
In America, marriage is a sacrifice. It's less you have morals.
Mm-hmm.
I just said that only men with moral, it will stay married.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good to pick men with morals.
A man with morals.
And good character. Because if you don't have those, you know what you need a wife for in America? Because, God forgive me, I know there's some going to say, why is it there that? We want a husband. But they spend too much time sewing, improving the outside, not picking up what's in that person inside.
Mm-hmm.
And then what kind of skill they have that will make them a great wife and a great mother.
Mm-hmm. But you're not saying that they can't also be a working mother or wife?
No, they can work, but back home.
Okay.
I used to have a friend who was a judge.
Mm-hmm.
But, and she have a, you know, Africa, we have maids.
Mm-hmm.
And the weekend,
she's
in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
Because her husband said, today you're not working. You got to cook, my wife got to cook my food.
Mm-hmm.
That's African man.
Mm-hmm.
I remember one time, you know, your dad and I get into some, that just because I have to get up and make his plate. Mm-hmm. I'm like, well, more. My sister-in-law was with us.
Mm-hmm.
So we cook and we were just eating and then he was praying and when he finished, and I would say, well, let me go and mix uncle. He said, no, she's going to get up and make my plate. Mm-hmm. And see, I said, no, don't worry, I'm going to make his plate. Oh, so not only I'm going to make your food, but I'm going to make your plate too. Yeah.
Well, those are the characteristics that I think the men are kind of moving away from, hopefully, these days. Because the women today, I don't know if we would be so compliant.
But you try to protect yourself. But I can tell you could be professional. Uh-huh. And you can have a job. Mm-hmm. But you still have to know your place. Mm. That is true. You have to know your place. And that doesn't make you like, and here it's all about, well, you know, they compete with the guys, mm-hmm. you know, and, but again, a lot of women, they're in a better situation and better position than men.
Yeah.
You know, they got their degrees, they got their businesses, they got great jobs. Mm-hmm. So they're into the marriage for any something else besides just the finance. So mm-hmm. they got their businesses, so they're not going to cook for you, clean for you. Mm-hmm. But it's just all communication. Because mm-hmm. people's going to have their difference, but you can, if you communicate, mm-hmm. all that can work out. Mm-hmm. That depends who make more money. Mm-hmm. If the wife is making more money and the husband decide we're paying too much tax, one can stay home and one keep the job, mm-hmm. and then find a helper.
Mm-hmm. You mean like a house husband or no?
Well, I know African, you wouldn't find a house husband in Africa for sure, because African man is not going to be a house husband. I remember, well, if you ask your brothers, they were going to tell you. Only time your daddy ever got in the kitchen is when I'm in a hospital having a baby. Mm. And as soon as I come home and lay the baby, I'm in the kitchen.
Yeah.
And the kids will say, oh, Mom, I'm glad you come. My daddy was just putting everything in a pot. And
yeah, I've had my dad's cooking before. There was cucumbers in there, ever lettuce. I'm like, Papa, I love you, but this is not. Let's just go get a Happy Meal. How about let's just do a Happy Meal?
No, they said, he's like, Mom, my daddy was just putting everything. Because we're not going to even allow that. We mm-hmm. never, we're not going to allow a husband in the kitchen cooking, period.
Yeah. But has the time, no, I'm not going to say has the time changed, because for me personally, I love to cook, so that's not going to be an issue. But just on average, women today, do you think that?
Well, here in America, mm-hmm. but not in Africa. I don't care what time we're in. Mm-hmm. You would never, if you allow your husband in Africa to cook, mm-hmm. oh, you're going to be talk of the town. Mm-hmm. And him too. They're like, well, what kind of husband is that? What kind of wife did he got? Mm-hmm. You wouldn't do it, not wash dishes, take trash and all. Your daddy never pulls the trash to the curbs all the
years. Wait, did you do that?
Yes.
So I thought trash maybe is a man's job.
Well, that's what Americans say, African.
Okay, you know, not. This whole American, African, I just can't win. Okay, so that's an American thing.
I'm teaching you the African way.
So wait, what does a man do then?
Well, normally,
okay,
men will be works.
Normally they work.
The woman got their job too, mm-hmm. but the job, the man's job is to take care of the family. Mm-hmm. Discipline the kids. Mm-hmm. Make sure, that's what, you know, you're the father's the provider, then the guardians and the mm-hmm. teacher. Mm-hmm. The mom at home too, because mm-hmm. men work, then, you know, you got, that's why you, it's always have, good to have a smart woman. If you work, she'll know how to distribute the finance, mm-hmm. make sure, you know what they say that, and it's true. Every successful man has a great woman behind him. Mm-hmm. Now, you can work all you want, but if you don't have a smart woman who knows how to work your finance, mm-hmm. you can work to that, but they come and they go. Mm-hmm. So you got to have a good woman who knows how to extract your finance. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter if you're a millionaire or a thousandaire. Mm-hmm. So that's one of those things. That.
So what about important. What if, okay, the husband and the wife is both well
working.
Off. Mm-hmm. Okay, or working mm-hmm. and can afford maids. Now, is that what you're saying? Like on the weekends, she can cook and stuff.
Well, I'm gonna still go back.
I thought I had this figured out. I guess I don't.
I'm gonna have to go back in Africa and America.
Okay.
Now let me just America stuff.
Okay, we're still talking about. Yeah, let's talk about Mom. We gotta talk about America. I'm asking for me.
Like I know where you're going.
Yes.
It's okay. Going if I get married, my husband. Now let me just tell you something.
I don't mind cooking and cleaning this. I mean, but that's because I don't mind to. I'm not gonna be feeling like, oh, he's making me cook or clean, because I'm a clean person and I love to eat.
Well, let me just tell you one thing in America now that I learned.
Okay.
The old way thing was, you just want to slave me, I'm cooking and I'm cleaning. Well, this is your job. Now, okay, no, this
see,
is...
This, I think this is go back to like the how you say things thing.
See, Well, let me just tell you, this really is good. If you have a...
Yeah. Well, I guess I'm not going to look at it as a job, is what I'm saying.
Well, no, no. Yeah. If you have a husband that financially secure, where you can get extra help.
Right. That's true.
Yes. You got extra help, like we do back home, because if you don't have your finance together, you got to work, your husband, you got to work together. Mm-hmm. He can help you. Like some men, Khan, when he was young, he'll come from his school, put his bag. So before he do his own work, he'll go and make himself a nice sandwich. I used to be like, what?
Yeah. This was boy, it a grilled cheese sandwich? I was talking to him about grilled cheese sandwiches.
And he do know how to make great sandwiches.
Yes. See, I told y'all. We got to get him in the kitchen, see if he can make anything else. It's some grilled cheese sandwiches, isn't it?
Even though I cook at that time, he just want to make himself that. And then he'll sit in the table with his earphone on, doing his homework. And I'll come in, you know, African mom. Boy, what you doing? Do your homework. It's like, mom, listening, that make me think. That time, I don't know how important it is for where he is yesterday. Mm-hmm. I'm one of those mothers thinking we African. Go to school, get be a lawyer, be a doctor, be a pilot, and he wanted to be a pilot. Mm-hmm. Music, not something we thought was going to be something. Mm-hmm. And I like children back then. Mm-hmm. And now, because there's Akon and other artists, they're successful with their talent, all moms are pushing their kids to go in and do arts and singing and dancing, but before it wasn't popular. Now, if African will tell you, if a man came in back then, want to marry your daughter, and he's a drummer, dancer, or something, oh no. And then somebody else will come in and say, I'm a teacher, I'm a doctor, they say, yeah, let him marry him. That's just the way it is. They didn't take the art as that serious. It's the, something you just do when you have baby naming, wedding, ceremonial, something you do for free. It wasn't something you just use like we do now.
Now, but you can actually make money and support your family.
Support your family. It wasn't, they just, you come in and somebody send them money and everybody give you money. You know, you, but that's it. It's not, just not a,
not a profession,
professional. Professional. So if you're married to a dancer, they say like, oh, the husband, he's a dancer. That's all he does. That was back then. Now that's like 40 some years ago, or please. Now, things change. So they just get more educated. So people are encouraging their kids to join the art. Another thing I wish they do, when the kids join the art, they drop out of school. Knowing that you need both. Because in this business, you have to be educated. If you, I tell them, if you wanted to be an entertainer, get your high school diploma, then you can go and continue your art. But don't drop out before you get your high school diploma and then want to be an artist. That's the only thing that now is wrong. Everybody want to be an artist, but nobody want to go to school.
That's true. That's true.
And you know me, education is very important.
Yes.
I encourage all my children, even the ones thought, oh, I don't want to go to school, Matthew. You got to go to school, not in this house.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah.
I wanted to start my own hair braiding shop. I actually didn't want to go to college, but she was like, no, go to college, which I'm grateful for now that I did go to college, because I went from getting my bachelor's to my master's under her guidance. So that was a good call. I will say that was a good call. But before I let you go, you know, we have to talk to our Senegalese people. Parce que buguma ñom ñu xalaat ne fatin
nañu len.
Fatin nañu len. Wow, legi esam bi ñi ngi waxtaan ak sama yaay ak jaar jaaram, xam nga mom Senegalese la. Ño fofu ba fi me dem ba am ay dom bu xamanteni ay américain nañu
dom yu juddo amérique
ñu juddu amérique yow xam nga ay américain nga ñi woy lo tax ma wax lo waxna ay sénégalais lañu ay sénégalais lañu waaw waye mang kay laaj nonu nan la démé pour mo mëna do I really know how to do this mala
pour mu expliquer ñu nan ñi yaré dom domi africaine nu ñuy yare sen dom
ba ñi xam ni senegal lañ juggé ay domu senegal lañu xam nga lool la ko won naaj waxtaan bi yépp lool la won légui est ce que am nga lo xamanteni
ba diko wax ni ko ñun africaine fuñu mën di dem
wa
néna ñu jeun xeer lu mu yag yag ci geej diko taxa nek jeun africa tell that in america no matter how rock stay in the ocean is never been a come a fish That's, you know, that's wolof. Rock can live in this ocean for years, but when in time you pull it, it's going to be a rock. It never come a fish. So as African, we can never change our
Who
culture
we are.
Because of where we live.
Right.
So lo la ko don wax mané ko liñuy wax ñun African, né nañu dom, jigé nit lañuy wax sax. Suñu xalé yi ni leen di yaré, fi ci Amérique pour won len ñu xam fu ñu joggé ndax xeer lu mu yag yag ci geej muñu nekk jël té li ñu defon ci ñun mom lañu bëgg def suñuy doom na bamay joggé Sénégal nak yag na fi la sama anniversaire 18 ans fi la ko défé mënon na nekk luma neex mais dama am frontière li nga xamné suma néwon Sénégal duma ko def suma nekké Amérique tax ma def ko ndax yaré wuñ ma non so limal daat jangal toujours yak sa mak yi di len wax ñun africaine li lañuy def la lañuy def légui da ngay dem Sénégal li nga may wax moy yaay Sénégal yo limu doon wax yeb neeku fa mané ko man bama fay jégué doon la mélon deug la Sénégal sansé na ndax parents ay jëlatuñu responsabilité yaré wutuñu suñ doomi nañu yaré won kon so bëggé sa doob melni yow delu ca yar bañ la yoron nga yar ko ko suko defé fuñ taxaw nga sigg ndax nenañ doom su baaxé ñepp ko jur waye su boné sa yaay rek la jur kon sant na yalla yalla mayna ma doom yo xamné ku nekk bëggoon la ko jur tay
kon ma ngi lay sant di la gërëm di ñaan yalla mu bay la fi ba ci kanam ak kanam sa ordonnance
ko suma be ordonnance ngeen jënd ko
ki mom sax ordonnance gis nga ko ki mom but no for real, like we're thanking you for coming here well I'm thanking you what's your size thanking you we're all thanking you for coming here and being with us today sharing your wisdom with us no matter how you gave it to us we took it like grown men and women but we do welcome you here again I'm sure we're going to have you here multiple times because there's so much to talk
we'll
about
we'll do Senegalese cooking next time
yes
but I'm going to tell you too myself
okay,
honestly
to
I'm a very proud mom I'm going to tell you how this has been to raise kids in America I'm very proud because there's people who actually probably work as hard as me it's just I got the tools that probably they didn't have so you guys who wonderful kids, easy to raise. You didn't give me hard time.
I don't think you let us give you a hard time. But okay, well, I'll take it. Thank you. We didn't give you a hard time.
No, I'm really proud because you know what they say, you raise all these kids and at least, you know what they say, 75% is 100% perfect. It's not easy. Thanks to my son. He treat me like a queen. Thanks to you. You make me proud that the woman that I had raised.
Thank you.
So I could not ask for it. Thank God. I just wish we all live. I just pray we live here long enough to see all of this is coming.
Inshallah. Yes.
I'm happy.
Yes.
God bless.
We're happy. You're happy. Thank you, guys. Thanks for joining us today.
Yo, what's up? It's me, Jonathan the Medium. I am here with Hot Tea on What's Your Side. We are doing a segment on what is spirituality and also, do you really know who you are?